चलो ठीक है। I usually forget the pen drive. That's why I just took it immediately. उसमें क्या होता है कि then I have to come all the way to get it.
Welcome once again, dear friends, in the live interactive teleconference of PGDCC program. Today we are going to discuss one of the valvular heart disease, and that is aortic stenosis. Before going to this topic, I would like to introduce the expert for today's discussion. He is Dr. Jayashankar. Earlier, he was our program in charge in Frontier Lifeline Hospital in Chennai, and these days he is involved in this program through Delhi Heart and Lung Institute. And I would like to have few announcements for all of you. First of all, is the result of the last June 2007 will be available within 2 weeks. examination for the first year students who has taken a admission in the 2007 will be in the month of December. That is the term end examination, and for that you need to form a pro forma. And previously that form was filled without any payment, but this year onward, means this time onward, it will be 50 rupees for each course. You are going to appear for the four examination, that is MCC 001 to 004. So that means you need to require for 200 rupees for fill up of this form. And I also request all of you, please send the feedback pro forma for the teleconference sessions. This feedback pro forma is available in your program guide. It is required very much, because we need to assess ourselves and we need to reply our authorities that how useful this program is. If it is benefited, then we will continue. Otherwise, if it is not benefited, then why should we waste all the resources? Not going into any other issues, I would like to start the discussions. All of you know that aortic stenosis is one of the important valvular heart diseases. Aortic valve is situated in between the aorta and left ventricle. So when it is narrowed, the blood which is supposed to go the cardiac output is not able to go proper way, and the amount of workload for the left ventricle is increased. So this is the main reason for this disease. And definitely Dr. Jaishankar is here to discuss everything of this disease in detail. So I'd like to request Dr. Jaishankar, please start with this topic.
Thank you, Dr. Biplab. Good morning, dear friends. We begin right away. You can have this projection somewhere.
Please, slide.
Slides can be projected, please. Yeah. Dr. Biplab has given an introduction why the aortic valve is important. We know that it's the aortic valve is going to cater to the left ventricular blood, which is going to come out, and it is going to stand the systemic pressure. So it is subjected to a lot of wear and tear. So if it is structurally abnormal, then it causes problem in later on in life. So we begin with the slides are not coming. This is a cranial view of the aortic valve. That is, when we cut upon the aorta from above, cross section, and we can see three cusps. There, out there, is the left coronary cusp. Sorry, this is the right coronary cusp. This is the left coronary, and that's the non-coronary. The same way we see the aortic valve in cross section in 2D short axis view. Similar. Posterior to the valve, down where the arrow goes, is where the left atrium is located. So you can see this is the three cusps are looking like cups. So they are something like this. They are going to open and close. Anything which causes problem at the level of the commissures, meaning commissural fusion, or thickening of the cusps, or rigidity of the cusps, or lack of movement of the cusps, can impede blood flow from left ventricle to the aorta. So we have to be very clear here, because the etiology varies depending on which part of the aortic valve is involved. Commissure is the line of fusion of the cusps. This is the base of the cusp. So the base of the cusp can get damaged. The cusp per se can get damaged. The line of fusion of the cusp, that is the commissure, can get involved. Or all the three can be present in the same pathology, impeding blood flow and narrowing the aortic valve. You can feel free to stop me at any stage. So having said that, one slide before this is a normal tricuspid aortic valve. Perfect cross section, three cusps which are equal in size, they oppose well and open well. So a bicuspid aortic valve, as you see here, has only two cusps, one above and one below. Here you may not be able to tell which is left, which is right, or which is non-coronary cusp, because the closure line can be anyway. Here it is horizontal like this. You may have a diagonal closure line, you may have a vertical closure line. Most often two cusps are joined together and they present a raphae in between, the line of commissures. And these cusps, which appear equal, one may be a fully developed cusp, the other one may be two cusps with a raphae in between. Am I clear here? So basically it is functionally two cusps for all practical purposes. The third cusp probably is rudimentary, and then here of course is two equal cusps causing a bicuspid aortic valve. Sometimes we may have a rudimentary sort of cusp which gets incorporated into one of the two cusps and gets joined by a median raphae. And as I said, the closure line can be in any direction. The one shown pictographically here has a horizontal line of closure. So aortic valve stenosis or left ventricular outflow tract obstruction is known to occur at three levels. So we are going to discuss only what happens at the valvular level. There is something which happens below the valve and something which can happen above the valve. So this topic of today's discussion is going to be only valvular aortic stenosis. Maybe we will touch briefly the other two. The picture shown here in valvular aortic stenosis, now you can see how the cusps are unequal. This cusp, which is the non-coronary cusp, has become thick. You see the cusps have become thick and rolled. The line of commissural fusion is narrow. And you can see the orifice in diastole is pretty small. So this is a classical rheumatic aortic valve involvement which is prevalent in this part of the world alone. Probably in sub-Saharan Africa and Southeast Asia, but we have the highest incidence of rheumatic heart disease. So commissural fusion, rolling in, you see how it, you can probably go back a couple of slides to see how it was before the normal cusp. See how thin the cusp is. And the same thing when rheumatic process affects the valve, it becomes thick and gets rolled in. The line of commissural fusion, which should be free to open and close, is fused, and you see the cusp itself is thickened. All the three I told in the beginning itself, this we should understand the cusps before we go and fix the etiology. So commissural fusion, rolling of the cusp after thickening, and calcification are hallmarks of rheumatic heart disease. So the same thing when we view on echocardiography, we see what's called systolic doming and thickening of leaflets. I'll be coming to that later on. So next most important, though these are not the common causes of aortic stenosis, next most important is degenerative aortic valve. The most common cause of aortic stenosis isolated is bicuspid aortic valve, which I told initially. Degenerative is one which occurs with age, usually occurs in the elderly beyond 65 years of age. They have other causes for atherosclerosis like hypertension, diabetes, deranged lipids, increased lipoprotein A levels, history of smoking. This is what happens. The base of the cusp, there is calcareal deposit. This is all calcium. You can see here, and this, all the three leaflets. The line of fusion of the commissure is not affected. There is fibrosis of the valve, that's why it's thick, it's shiny, and the calcification which is present at the base, the leaflet also thickens here. Again, the hallmark of a stenotic valve, whether it is aortic or pulmonary or mitral, is systolic doming and thickening. Systolic doming means it doesn't open freely. It is going to open and stop midway, and that's what is appreciated on echocardiography. The most common cause for valvular aortic stenosis is congenital. Usually it's on a bicuspid aortic valve. The child is born with a bicuspid valve, does not develop symptoms right away. Due to wear and tear over many decades, usually third to fourth decade, the cusps become, they get degenerated, and the stenosis is progressive, and they present to us in the third or fourth decade of life. This is a pictorial which shows a thickened ventricle. And you can see the left ventricular output tract, and that's the aorta out there, the arrow. Because the valve is stenosed out there, it's not going to open freely in systole, it's going to dome. That's what is systolic doming. The pressure in the ventricle has to increase manifold to sustain a fixed cardiac output. Fixed cardiac output meaning this valve is going to be fixed whether it is systole or diastole. It's going to allow a fixed amount of blood only because of narrowing. The ventricle has to act much more than its capacity to generate that cardiac output. Say for instance the cardiac output is 4 liters per minute. Patient has severe aortic stenosis. To maintain that 4 liters per minute, the left ventricular systolic pressure has to increase manifold over and above the aortic pressure, the brachial pressure, to generate that 4 liter per minute. Am I clear here? So there it's a pictorial which shows a thickened ventricle, a elevated left ventricular pressure of 180/80 against the aortic valve which is stenosed, which shows systolic doming, and there we have the aortic or brachial pressure of 110/80. So this is where the gradient is 70 millimeter mercury straight away. 180 is the systolic pressure in the ventricle, 110 is the systolic aortic pressure, the systemic pressure. The difference between the two systolic pressures is 70 millimeter mercury. Irrespective of etiology of aortic stenosis, this is what is going to happen eventually. Which occurs early, which occurs late is the issue. So having said valvular aortic stenosis, I think we should touch upon what happens below the valve. Sometimes we can have rarely what's called subvalvular aortic stenosis. You can see this black ridge shaped structure just underneath the valve. The valve is not doming here. Please note this valve, the previous one, which was doming. If you see the arrow and you see the valve, it's having the U-shaped appearance. This obstruction is all below the valve. That's why it's called subvalvular aortic stenosis. Again, whatever the cause for the LVOT obstruction, the left ventricle is unable to pump out blood. If the obstruction is severe, it has to increase its systolic pressure manifold to generate that fixed cardiac output to maintain a systemic arterial pressure of 110/80. So irrespective of where the obstruction is, the pathophysiology is the same. So when we have what's called dynamic obstruction, dynamic meaning it can change from time to time, it varies with time to time. It may change with increase in cardiac output, it may change with increase in heart rate, it may change with increase in blood pressure, it may change with increase in adrenergic drive. Patient is over anxious, has a stressful period, the gradient may increase. That's called dynamic. That's what happens in hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. The terminology speaks for itself. There is a hypertrophic ventricle. It obstructs the flow of blood flow, and it is a problem of the muscle, cardiomyopathy. So hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy can have a dynamic obstruction which varies depending on the state of the individual, depending on the heart rate, depending on the blood pressure, depending on the adrenergic drive to get the gradient. So meaning sometimes the LV systolic pressure may be normal. When the gradient increases, the LV systolic pressure has to rise to generate the cardiac output. Other one is fixed, where it behaves just like a valvular aortic stenosis. Only thing is the valve is normal and there is a ridge shaped structure under the valve, beneath the valve, which is of two or three types. I am not going to talk about that. Commonest is membranous, and that can also lead to, it behaves just like a valvular aortic stenosis. After valvular and subvalvular, there is something called supravalvular, which is above the valve level. You can see this hourglass sort of narrowing beyond the origin of the coronaries. These are the two coronary arteries. Beyond that is this hourglass constriction and then the aorta. So supravalvular aortic stenosis again is of three types. It can be a tubular narrowing, it can be membranous, or it can be hourglass as shown in this picture. So in this case, because there is obstruction to flow, again the LV systolic pressure has to rise, it is also 180, but at the valve it continues to be 180 because the obstruction is above the valve, and beyond the obstruction the systemic arterial pressure is 110/80. So whether it is valvular, subvalvular or supravalvular, the LV pressure has to increase to generate that fixed cardiac output. The treatment varies for all the three. So the most common site of obstruction to left ventricular outflow tract is the aortic valve, at the aortic valve level. 95% out of 100 cases, the obstruction is at the valvular level. 3-5% is the incidence of obstruction at the subvalvular level, and 1% is the obstruction above the valve. So if you happen to get features of aortic stenosis on clinical examination, you go ahead and do an echocardiography, you see a left ventricular hypertrophy, you see increased gradients across the left ventricular outflow tract, but you see that the valve is structurally normal. Immediately you should be alerted to the possibility of a subvalvular or a supravalvular aortic stenosis. Valvular aortic stenosis has three main causes. I told earlier, the commonest cause is congenital, against the backdrop of a bicuspid aortic valve. The child is born normally with two cusps alone, continues to behave normally for the next 3 to 4 decades due to progressive wear and tear. Because the LV pressure is systemic, you need three cusps to open and close to sustain that systemic pressure, where only two cusps, due to wear and tear, they get degenerated with time and the obstruction becomes progressive. Rheumatic heart disease is rare. Isolated aortic valve involvement with rheumatic heart disease is very rare. It always occurs concomitant with a mitral valve involvement. The incidence of aortic valve isolated stenosis is 4%. So we don't have to really bother about that. However, if we have mitral valve disease, we need to look carefully at the aortic valve because the management changes. And of course, the second most common is degenerative, which occurs in the elderly beyond 65 years of age. Rather, the commonest cause of aortic stenosis in the adults beyond 60 years of age is degenerative. There are other rare causes of aortic stenosis which occur in systemic diseases like rheumatoid arthritis, which usually presents with aortic regurgitation due to rheumatoid nodules, Paget's disease of the bone due to hypercalcemic state, same thing with end stage renal disease, and alkaptonuria or ochronosis. These are rare causes of aortic stenosis. The examiners may sometime like to find out whether we know other these causes, but they are rarely of clinical importance. However, if we encounter a patient with end stage renal disease who has severe aortic stenosis, we should have this as the cause in mind. More importantly, aortic stenosis is probably a disease of males. It is much more commoner in males than in women. So even in clinical practice, if you happen to see, the incidence is something like 4:1. So I already told about this. Congenital aortic stenosis is usually on a bicuspid valve. It is due to abnormal architecture. Instead of three cusps, there are only two. These cusps are unable to withstand the systemic pressure of the left ventricle, deteriorate gradually over many years, decades, lead to progressive fibrosis, leads to rigidity of the valve, freedom of movement of the valve is restricted, the mobility is lost, and eventually goes on and progresses on to a severe aortic stenosis. I told this earlier also. Bicuspid aortic valve rarely ever present symptomatically in childhood. They are usually picked up in adulthood in the 3rd and 4th decades of life, for the reason just explained. Important point to remember is often familial. Nowadays, it is probably recommended to screen first degree relatives of patients with bicuspid aortic valve. It is autosomal dominant with incomplete penetrance, meaning it is transmitted from one generation to the next, but not all manifest. So first degree relatives may have bicuspidiatric valve, but they may not have increased gradients, but they can pass it on to the next generation. So we are supposed to do a pedigree chart when we have a patient of isolated aortic valve involvement in the young and we suspect a bicuspidiatric valve. Important point again is bicuspid valve also leads to systemic medial necrosis, and per se without any increase in gradient of the aortic valve can cause dilatation of the ascending aorta. So ascending aorta dilatation in bicuspid valve is because of cystic medial degeneration, which is known to occur in bicuspid aortic valve. We saw the picture of rheumatic AS where there was adhesion and fusion of the line of fusion of commissures. The cusps become thick, they become rigid, and there is systolic doming. Important point to remember, why I am harping on this is, we should never make a diagnosis of rheumatic aortic stenosis in the absence of mitral valve disease, usually associated in the backdrop of associated mitral valve disease. Rarely ever rheumatic occurs isolated. Rare is the affection of the aortic valve by rheumatic process, isolated rheumatic aortic valve involvement. Probably I can go a step further in telling, at your level it does not ever cause isolated aortic valve involvement. When you get aortic valve disease, even in your exam, you have to try and fix an etiology of bicuspid, that is congenital, or a degenerative. Unless you strongly suspect mitral valve involvement on clinical examination, please try and avoid fixing etiology as rheumatic. Important point to remember is, it does not cause isolated aortic stenosis. Due to rolling in of the cusps, they also leak. Whether it is systole or diastole, it is going to remain like that. So patients often have both valvular lesions, stenosis as well as regurgitation. I told earlier also, degenerative aortic stenosis is probably the most common cause for severe aortic stenosis in adults beyond 65 years of age. It has been found in epidemiological studies that when elderly are screened above 65 years of age, 2 out of every 100 elderly will have critical or severe AS, though they may not be symptomatic. So 2% is quite a high prevalence. This is on a structurally normal tricuspid aortic valve. It's not a bicuspid valve. Commonest cause of aortic stenosis in the elderly beyond 65 years of age is degenerative. This occurs on the backdrop of a structurally normal tricuspid aortic valve. It's not a bicuspid valve which gets degenerated. And 2 out of every 100 elderly patients will have severe aortic stenosis. Again, this has some resemblance to mitral valve disease when it occurs in the elderly. Usually it coexists with isolated mitral valve involvement in the form of mitral annular calcification, because the pathology is same. Hypertension, diabetes, smoking, hypercholesterolemia, these are the risk factors to develop what's called aortosclerosis, which goes on to become aortic valve stenosis, associated mitral valve stenosis. So when we have isolated aortic stenosis in the elderly, we should also look carefully for mitral valve involvement, because we know that mitral annular calcification often always coexists and it's an important cause for mitral regurgitation. So instead of intervening or taking care of only the aortic valve, you may have to touch the mitral valve also. So when we assess the patient, that needs to be kept in mind. The risk factors are similar to atherosclerosis. I just told, smoking, diabetes, hypertension, raised LDL cholesterol are well known risk factors for aortosclerosis, similar to atherosclerosis, which progresses on to become aortic valve stenosis. Same is the risk factor for mitral annular calcification. I forgot to add end stage renal disease out here due to hypercalcemic state. Because it happens, the risk factor profile is similar to atherosclerosis, there is an increased risk of MI and cardiovascular death in this population. So it is not uncommon to find patients beyond 65 presenting to us with acute myocardial infarction on examination found to have aortic stenosis, which was until recently didn't have any symptoms to get presented. The clinical presentation of severe AS, it's mind-boggling, is usually they are asymptomatic. Most often they are picked up on routine clinical examination when they go for some school health checkup, go for jobs, or detected on routine examination for some lower respiratory infection to go to the GP. He auscultates and finds a murmur. That's how they come to our attention. And when you inquire or dig deep into the history, you'll find that the child or adult would be running half an hour a day without any discomfort. But once they become symptomatic, there are three cardinal symptoms of aortic stenosis: angina, dyspnea, and syncope. 75% of patients who are symptomatic with valvular or subvalvular or supravalvular aortic stenosis have angina or chest pain. That is because the ventricle is thick, there is subendocardial ischemia, there is supply demand mismatch. As simple as that, the cardiac output is fixed. The moment the child or adult starts running, the coronary perfusion is low because the cardiac output is fixed. You need more oxygen on exertion. So angina without coronary artery disease. This is due to increased demand, as we see with left ventricular hypertrophy. In elderly, we should always have, as I said earlier, coexistent coronary artery disease. Patients with acute MI may present to us. We go on to examine them only to find that they have coexistent aortic stenosis. So the causes for chest pain in a patient of severe aortic stenosis, one, may be normal coronary, just left ventricular hypertrophy due to supply demand mismatch. On exertion, the patient gets the pain relieved by rest, classical angina. When they are coexistent with a coronary artery involvement, coronary artery disease, rarely, very rarely, is calcium emboli, because the valve is degenerated, there is calcareous deposit. Fragments of calcium can migrate up, go to the brain, cause TIA, can migrate down the coronaries, causing calcium emboli. Next in line is syncope. Why it is important to ask these histories in a patient of aortic stenosis is, we are supposed to intervene the moment we have angina, dyspnea, or syncope. If a patient is asymptomatic, we may choose to follow them up. Again, there is a lot of raging controversy on this. Syncope is loss of consciousness due to decreased cardiac output. It is due to reduced cerebral perfusion, which occurs with exertion. Important point to remember here is, this syncope is not going to occur at rest. The cardiac output, as I said earlier, is fixed because of LVOTU or left ventricular outflow tract obstruction. The ventricle adapts to this obstruction by increasing its systolic pressure. However, with exertion, it is unable to increase the demand any further because the outflow is obstructed. It is going to be a fixed cardiac output. When you need more oxygen to the brain, as we require to other viscera, that's when the patient gets syncope, not at rest. Malfunction of baroreceptor mechanism. The carotid baroreceptors are well suited to this left ventricular hypertrophy and fixed obstruction. With time, they do not respond. That is why one of the mechanisms of syncope is, see what happens when we are supine and get up. The baroreceptors come into play. They keep the pressure intact, because with standing, there is peripheral pooling of blood, less blood comes to the heart has to pump vigorously. This is all regulated by carotid baroreceptors and LV mechanoreceptors, left ventricular mechanoreceptors. Both of them with time become dysfunctional and cause syncope in aortic stenosis. If a patient of aortic stenosis gets syncopal attacks at rest, it's due to an arrhythmia, and it's very rare. It occurs with ventricular fibrillation, which can be transient, VF, due to electrical inhomogeneity, because the ventricle is thick. We know that the myocardium is syncytial, crisscross fibers. There is problem in conduction across the fibrils because of thickened ventricle. That is the reason patient may develop ventricular arrhythmias causing syncope while at rest. But classical syncope is occurring on exertion. During the soccer days in Europe, many patients are found, athletes are known to collapse, the football players, and on examination they are found to have HOCM or aortic stenosis. Another cause for rare cause for syncope, these two are rare, it AV conduction block, because it's all heavily calcified valve that can migrate from the valve to the conduction system. As the calcium gets deposited, it's going to get deposited like piles. It piles up one over the other. It can damage the nearby conduction system and cause AV blocks and a syncope. Another important symptom is dyspnea. Dyspnea can take the form of orthopnea, it can be paroxysmal nocturnal or pulmonary edema. It's all due to raised pulmonary venous hypertension. As the ventricle becomes stiff, the left ventricular end diastolic pressure rises, the left atrial mean pressure rises, that is backward, the pressure is transmitted backward, there is pulmonary venous pressure which is raised, that causes the dyspnea. Why these three symptoms are important? I said earlier that we need to intervene the moment the patient gets symptomatic, because with onset of angina, the survival is known to be only 5 years, and the survival is least once dyspnea, PND or orthopnea is going to occur, 2 years. Syncope is intermediate. So the moment you find someone who is asymptomatic with severe AS, we need to dwell deep into the history, keep asking him probing questions to find out he or she, does he get dyspnea, angina or syncope, because we need to intervene earlier in those cases. Coming to physical examination, starting from the pulse, because the ventricle is going to eject against resistance, the ejection is going to be slow and sustained. It's not going to be like this. It's going to be slow and sustained. So same, it's reflected in the periphery. The pulse is going to be slow rising. It's not going to have a rapid peak and rapid downstroke. Slow, small and sustained pulse, or other words called pulsus parvus et tardus, is classically described for aortic stenosis. If you palpate the apical impulse and also the carotid simultaneously, one can appreciate a distinct gap. Normally they should be synchronous. If there is a distinct gap between the left ventricular apical impulse and the carotid, it's called apico-carotid delay. It's a sign of aortic stenosis or severe aortic stenosis. Because of the stiff ventricle, the atrial pressure rises, which is reflected onto the JVPS, a tall A wave. One may find prominent A waves on examination. Very rare again is features of right side heart failure. Because of the thickened left ventricle, the ventricle bows into the right ventricle, impeding inflow of blood into the right ventricle. It's called Bernheim effect, and patient may have features of right heart failure. Auscultation usually reveals, because everything is on the aortic valve, unless the mitral valve is involved, the S1 is going to be normal. The second heart sound, you know that the A2 comes first, the P2 comes later. Because of calcification and immobility, the aortic component of second heart sound is usually inaudible. Hence, the second heart sound becomes single. S1 is normal, the S2 is single, A2 is inaudible due to immobility and calcification. S4 is a diastolic event. It occurs before the first heart sound. The moment the aortic valve is critically narrowed, the ventricle hypertrophies, the left ventricular end diastolic pressure is going to go up. We know that the left atrial mean pressure should be slightly higher than the left ventricular end diastolic pressure, so that the blood is easily able to cross the mitral valve and come into the ventricle. When the end diastolic pressure goes up, the atrial component of diastole, that is the late diastolic phase, normally with diastole, the early wave, E wave, due to just opening of the mitral valve, blood gushes down from the left atrium to left ventricle. 75% of the blood flows across the mitral valve this way. The latter half of diastole is due to atrial kick. So the ventricle becomes stiff, the end diastolic pressure rises, the atrial contribution to diastole has to increase, the atria has to contract more. That is reflected as a fourth heart sound. So S4 becomes prominent, it's a pre-systolic event, rather a late diastolic event. Another auscultatory hallmark is an ejection click, which occurs soon after the first heart sound. It depends on the valve mobility. The moment the valve is very rigid, fibrotic and calcific, this click will disappear. So an ejection click indicates mobility, nothing more. The murmur, the classical murmur of aortic stenosis is ejection systolic. It's heard at the base of the heart, second and right, left, second and third, left and right parasternal intercostal space. It is transmitted up to the carotid and down to the apex. That is the line of transmission. Again, just like the pulse, since the left ventricle is going to take a longer time to eject, the left ventricular ejection time is longer, there is a late peaking of the murmur instead of early peaking of murmur, which occurs in usual ejection murmurs. And we may get an impression of pan-systolic murmur because it may go and touch the second heart sound. But remember that second heart sound is not A2, it is P2. And this murmur buries or overlaps the A2. It overlaps the A2 because A2 is not audible. So we may confuse it with the pan-systolic murmur. It is ejection or a long-drawn systolic murmur, stops well before the second heart sound because the A2 is inaudible. It is going to stop before the P2. A word about a murmur which is described for aortosclerosis or a sclerotic degenerative aortic valve is Gallowardine phenomenon, which is seen in calcific AS where the calcium gets deposited at the base of the cusps. It doesn't affect the tips, affect the base of the cusp. So what happens when the cusp, the base of the cusp is damaged? The tips are freely mobile. So when the blood goes through that valve, it has two components. One is the harsh murmur because the valve is stenotic, and the fluttering of the tip of the leaflet, that's a high frequency murmur. Why it is important to know this phenomenon is, this murmur is, as for any AS murmur, going to be loud at the base. But selectively the high frequency sounds which emanate from the tips of the leaflet are going to get radiated to the apex. So that one may get confused as a mitral regurgitant murmur at the apex. So high frequency vibrations selectively transmitted to the apex, but a harsh murmur at the base is called Gallowardine dissociation because these are two murmurs from the same valve. That's why it's called dissociation. Gallowardine is the fellow who described this. So the murmur is loudest at the base and selectively high frequency vibrations are transmitted to the apex. So these are two murmurs which are distinct area of clear area between the two, between the base and the apex. So what happens when we have, what are the hemodynamic effects of this? Yeah. Can I use the this thing, board?
Yes, sir.
So this is left atrium. This is going to be the aorta, left ventricle. These are the two leaflets of the mitral valve, right coronary and the non-coronary cusp. With aortic sclerosis, the base of the cusp is going to get damaged with calcium. This cusp is still going to open and close freely. However, it is restricted at the base. So as it opens, it is going to open like this. It's not going to open freely because the base is restricted. So in view of this, you're going to get a harsh murmur because this is the area left second intercostal space. You're going to get a harsh murmur. But because the tips are still free. We know that when we water the plants at home, you have a tube to water the plants. If you want the next pot to be watered standing in the same place, you're going to press the tube. The velocity increases, the frequency is going to increase. Similarly, since the edge, though it is mobile, it's still stenotic. You're going to get high frequency sounds there, and that is that the line of transmission is like this. So it is going to get come to the apex. That's what you hear here. So fine sound here, harsh sound at the base. Both are emanating from the same valve. That is Galavadin dissociation. The hemodynamic effects are, in view of the stenosis, there is going to be post-stenotic dilatation of the ascending aorta beyond the obstruction. Proximal to obstruction, the ventricle has to pump vigorously. Over time, it hypertrophies. So, hypertrophy of the left ventricle is a sign of moderate or severe aortic stenosis. Since the ventricle becomes thick, it is unable to receive blood from the left atrium freely. The left atrium atrial contribution in diastole has to increase. The left atrium is going to pump. In later diastole, it may enlarge later on. It's a sign of decreased left ventricular compliance. So left atrial enlargement also occurs with, that's why even ECG we see, with LVH you also see left atrial enlargement. Usually the cavity of the left ventricle becomes smaller with a thick ventricle. But as the ventricle fails, to begin with, to compensate for this outflow obstruction, the ventricle pumps vigorously. But with time, it may fail and it doesn't generate the required cardiac output. It will start dilating and the patient will start having systolic dysfunction, which was earlier normal or supernormal. Okay, I think we'll stop here and have the investigations later on.
Yeah. If you have any questions regarding whatever is presented by this sir, you can feel free to ask. Regarding the symptoms, are actually one thing I want to make it clear is, like you have described that chest pain, syncope and dyspnea. So among them, which symptoms appear normally first, and like the survival rate related to the symptoms, how we can really describe?
Commonest symptom is angina.
Okay, which is the first, this is normally appearing.
It is seen in 75% of patients with aortic stenosis. The survival is also best for patients who have only angina.
Only angina.
So they live for 5 years from the date of onset of angina. This is from epidemiological studies. Yes. But the moment the patient starts getting dyspnea, it is a sign of raised pulmonary venous pressure. It is only time before which the heart is going to fail. Then the survival is as low as 2 to 2.5 years.
Dear friends, I think all of you can understand at least whatever is presented right now, like etiology, clinical symptoms, as well as physical examination of the aortic stenosis. In our next sessions, we will discuss about the investigations and management of the aortic stenosis. If you have any questions, you can send by fax or you can ask in between whenever this next presentation is going to happen. So here we will close the session. And next sessions will be after 15 minutes. Thank you very much.